for coming out. I'm going to step over these wires and
yeah.
all that. Thanks for coming out on a Monday night. Your talk about tax is not always the thing that people are most excited to spend their time hearing about, but pretty interesting nonetheless. So as Bert said, I work at Mass Budget and Policy Center, massbudget.org. We're a small nonprofit based in Boston that looks at state tax and budget issues, primarily through the lens of how they affect low and moderate income families in the state. We've been around for a bunch of years and issue reports regularly, try and sort of educate people about important issues and provide real information that legislators, the media, the general public can use in discussing and deciding about these important issues. I'm going to pass out a sign-up list if you want to get our emails, sort of our reports and stuff like that. Just put your name and email address on that list, and I'll enter it in the system, and you'll get our fact sheets and reports when they come out on a weekly basis. Feel free to sign up for that if you'd like to. So without further ado, jump into this. There's a lot of numbers and charts and graphs in the presentation that I'm about to give you, but we kind of like to take a step back at the beginning and just remind ourselves, our audience, what we're really talking about when we talk about the state budget, which is a whole series of programs that impact people in their daily lives throughout the Commonwealth. And that's a whole host of areas. So education, about a million kids attend K through 12 public education every day in Massachusetts. Tens of thousands of other older students go to the community colleges, state colleges, UMass system. And the quality of the education that they get in those schools certainly affects their future prospects, but it also affects the state economy as a whole. So this is a really important area of investment for the state, and one that we put a fair amount of money into, and which we pay for together using our taxes. Transportation, again, we have subways, buses, keeping the roads clear, keeping the roads in good shape, the bridge repair programs, all that stuff that is very important to everyone in the state and something we pay for together with our taxes. The libraries, like this one, parks, recreation, all that, things that people often take for granted. Of course, they're available to all of us because we have taxes and revenues and allocate those to the state budget and local budgets to pay for those things for ourselves and our neighbors. Public safety, core government function. Then we have ambulances, fire departments, local police forces. here's sort of an oftentimes invisible government function, but one that is very important nonetheless. We have clean, safe drinking water in the United States and in Massachusetts, clean air because we have regulations and we have regulatory systems that fund those things and make sure that they are, in fact, clean, they're safe to use. Through the prisons and the courts, pretty obvious public safety function for prisons and courts, but there's also a really important economic function for the court system. These are the mechanism through which we settle property disputes, contract disputes, etc. So you can't really have a modern functioning economy absent a well-operating court system. Healthcare and public health, this is a large area of spending. I mean, I don't know, many of you may be quite familiar with the state budget, but we spend a lot of money on public health, more so directly on healthcare. We about a quarter of the kids in Massachusetts actually are able to go to a doctor, go to a hospital if they need to, because there are state programs which allow those kids to get the care that they need. Same thing with elder care, nursing homes, very, very expensive. $70,000, $100,000 a year for a single person to go to a nursing home. Fortunately, not
how much?
$70,000 to $100,000 oftentimes, and not everybody needs that kind of level of care, which is great. But for people who do, very, very few families, even wealthy families, that is a lot of money. But those people get that care in Massachusetts because we have the systems and structures set up, and we pay for them together through our taxes. Finally, human services. This is a whole host of different kinds of programs. I mean, there's veterans services, there's disability services, there's elder services, there's child protective services. There's all kinds of programs that affect lots of people in their daily lives in very real ways throughout the Commonwealth every day. And those are programs that are available because we've agreed to pay for them together with our taxes. So that's sort of broad overview and general pitch for the importance of government, both state and local, in our lives. With that in mind, you know, some of you may very well already know the answer to this, but it's kind of an interesting exercise to often ask people, okay, given all that stuff that we've talked about, all the different ways that government, state and local is involved in day-to-day lives of people throughout the Commonwealth, the different programs, how much does that cost us? What share of all of the personal income generated each year in Massachusetts is collected in state and local taxes to pay for all those different services we've just been talking about, different kinds of programs? People know, some guesses, people want to throw out a guess on that?
What percentage of our income?
Yeah, total income for the state. So all the different people in the state generate about $440, $450 billion a year in income. You know, if you view that as a single pie, what percentage? How big is that slice of pie that's collected in state and local taxes? How much tax is collected?
5%.
5%?
1%.
What was that?
1%.
1%?
10 or under.
10 or under. So, you know, we often get like, you know, guesses of 20, 30%. You all are much closer. Last gentleman, very close. 10% in Massachusetts, a little over 10%. Go ahead.
You didn't mention recreation and the cost of government in your two slides.
So
the overview
was in there.
Oh, so the administrative, you know, the legislature, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, the administrative and recreation.
Yep.
Parks.
Parks and recreation, sort of. But you're right. That was not a full list, but you're absolutely right. There are all kinds of other ways that government's involved in our daily lives that requires funding. So is this a lot or a little? One way to get at that question is to compare it to other states. And what do you think? Massachusetts, a lot. How do we compare to other states? Are we relatively high, relatively low?
Higher, probably.
We're called Massachusetts, but
above average. I said below average.
So we got some good guesses in here. All basically kind of right, which is that Massachusetts is very average, actually, with regards to taxes relative to other states. You can see we're just above the national average. We're sort of, basically right in the middle there. North Dakota, Alaska, some of the states that have oil resources and have extractive severance taxes on extractive industries are very high. It's a little bit funny. But yeah, the basic idea, Massachusetts, not all that high relative to other states. So someone mentioned Massachusetts. Given that we're a pretty middle-of-the-road state, why is it that we are actually called Massachusetts? So here's a quick look at that question. So just to be clear here, you know, this chart, we've got states at the bottom, and we have total personal income generated in a state, the share of that total income collected in all state local taxes. So that's what this chart is showing here. Same basic chart here, but slightly different position, well, significantly different position for Massachusetts in here, right? Massachusetts is third from the top, 14% basically of personal income collected through state and local taxes, well above the U.S. average. So here we really are, Massachusetts, right? How would these charts be true? The data in both of these charts be true? People have a guess of what's different between these two charts here. Well, they're both the share of personal income collected through state and local taxes. That's not different. That's the same in both cases.
Go back to the previous slide.
It's kind of a trick question.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So this is not the same. It's state personal income, state local taxes.
It's the year.
It is the year. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So this is 40 years ago. 40 years ago, we had a much different tax system. And Massachusetts, relative to other states, was much higher, and we collected a significantly larger share of all the state personal income generated in Massachusetts at that time through state and local taxes. But you know, in the intervening 40 years, we've done a lot of tax cutting here in Massachusetts. You can see that in this next slide. Massachusetts has cut taxes more than any other state except Arizona during that period as a share of personal income. And we're well below the U.S. average of 10%. We cut a quarter off of our the amount of state, per, state personal income collected.
And I'm just trying to think, it seems to me, if I roll the tape, that it's sort of 50-50 Democratic, Republican governors?
I don't know offhand during that 40 years.
I think it's about
50. Other people may have a longer memory in that regard.
Right? Flip back and forth, right.
Well, there were 16 years in a row of Republicans, but before that, it was mostly Democrats.
Right, Dukakis and...
A lot of this change is due to Prop 2.5 back in the 1980s, which limited the growth in property taxes, and also a set of a pretty complicated state package back in the late 90s and early 2000s for a variety of different taxes, but heavily focused on income taxes. And we're going to actually talk about that next. So basic idea, takeaway from here is Massachusetts, despite claims to the contrary, is really a very middle-of-the-road state in terms of taxation. So we've been talking about state and local taxes combined up until now. I'm turning now to data that focuses specifically on state-level data. We're going to be talking more about state budget. This is state taxes, state-only taxes. They go to the Commonwealth, not to cities and towns. So we're talking primarily about sales taxes, income taxes, some of the fees and corporate taxes, et cetera. So what you can see here is that in the late 80s through the late 90s, Massachusetts, with the tax structure that was in place at that time, collected a very consistent 6.3% of the personal income generated in the state, you know, year after year, very consistent. In the late 90s, this was sort of the height of the dot-com era, we were, as a state, we were doing quite well revenue-wise. We were collecting more than we needed to spend in each given year, very often. We were putting money into the rainy day fund. We were making big investments in our rainy day fund. Many of the policy, budget debates during budget season each year were, which programs really deserved an increase in funding, how are we going to allocate this additional revenue that we had. There were folks at the time who decided that the dot-com era was a new economic paradigm, that this additional revenue was just going to keep rolling in forever. There were folks who warned that that was unlikely to be the case. But nevertheless, the debates at that time resulted in a tax package that was, the idea was to reduce this, what was seen as surplus revenue, and bring it down to a level that was just really what the state needed. There were warnings that it was actually going to be less potentially than the state needed if the economy turned in a different direction. But this tax package was put through and sort of was implemented over the course of 4 years. Actually, elements of it are still being implemented today. I don't know how closely people are following through the ratcheting down of the personal income tax rate. Just a couple years ago, it was 5.3%. We keep crossing these thresholds that were sort of set up back in the late 90s as part of this package that would ratchet down the rate when certain thresholds were met for increases in revenue relative to income increases. So now we're at 5.1%. So some of those changes are actually still taking effect. Most of them played out over the course of 4 years. And what we saw after that was that Massachusetts kind of dropped to a new level of revenue collection. We lost about a percentage point, and it's been very consistent thereafter. With state personal income at around $440-$450 billion a year, we're talking about the loss of in the neighborhood of $4-$4.5 billion of revenue annually from the state budget as a result of these set of changes. There are other factors, there are economic factors as well. These are a major driver of that reduction in revenue collection. There are three in particular that I want to highlight that were part of the package, and these were all part of the personal income changes made to the personal income tax. We had a rate change in personal income, dropped from then, at that time it was 5.95%, down to 5.3%, and as I was just mentioning, it's been ratcheting down towards 5% over the last few years. Today, that change alone costs $2.4 billion in revenue. If we hadn't made that change, the state would be collecting an additional $2.4 billion each year in revenue. Another change, a change to the dividend interest rate from 12% at that time, down to 5.3%, and now down to 5.1%. You know, these are both changes, particularly dividend and interest rate change, but these are both changes which disproportionately benefited upper income households rather than lower income households. And in particular, the dividend and interest change. You know, very, very few low and moderate income households are collecting very much in dividend and interest income. So that's a change that now costs close to $1 billion a year in lost revenue. And then the increase in the personal exemption. You're likely familiar with personal exemption. It's a sort of, you earn a certain amount of money, say, $30,000, and there's a lump sum that's taken off of that $30,000 set aside, and it's not subject to the income tax. Back in the late 90s, that was $2,200 a person, $4,400 for a married couple. That was increased to $4,400 per person and $8,800 per couple. So this change actually, as a share of household income, disproportionately benefits lower income households. It's a big share of the lower income household's total income set aside from taxes. But nevertheless, it's still costing the Commonwealth over $500 million a year in lost revenue. Yeah?
So what you're saying is that our personal income tax rate has dropped to a point that is higher than the rents that people get from dividends and interest. Dividends and interest are passive income.
Right.
Right? You don't do anything, you get the money. Pay taxes.
Right.
If I work and I pay taxes, I'm paying at a 5.3 rate. And if my money is working,
yeah,
and I'm not, and it's passive,
yep,
I'm paying at a 5.1 rate.
No, that's my mistake. I was unclear about that. Thanks for pointing that out. So at the time that these changes were made, both rates were dropped to 5.3%. In the intervening years, both rates, due to this sort of weird ratcheting down system, both rates have dropped to 5.1%. So they're comparable. They're the same. They're identical. So together, these tax cuts alone, are costing north of $3.5 billion a year in revenue that otherwise would be coming into the state, absent the changes.
What's the amount at the other end where people don't have to pay taxes over a certain amount of income?
Over a certain amount of income?
They pay taxes up to a certain amount, and if they make any money over that, they're not taxed.
Top marginal rate.
Yeah,
that's Social Security.
Yeah.
So you may be talking about Social Security. That would be an example of that where you don't. Yeah. Above, I think, $109,000, you don't actually pay Social Security taxes. So that's a federal, safety net.
Oh, it's just Social Security you don't pay on it.
Both state and federal.
Maybe you don't pay more. It's not like suddenly at $110,000 you stop paying Social Security at all. It just the rate stops.
Right. You don't pay additional. The discussion
here does not include the impact of the federal monies that are transferred to the state, right?
No, right here we're talking purely about understanding. Own source.
Understand. Yeah. But would we be self-sufficient as a state from just our personal income tax base?
No. So that could be a more complicated question it depends on how much money is actually flowing out to the federal government and then being returned back from the federal government. And I don't know the details on, the outflow versus the inflow. Obviously some states are getting more than they contribute. Other states are getting less. My suspicion would be that Massachusetts is a state that contributes more overall to the federal system and, to subsidize states, Mississippi, Louisiana, Arkansas, poorer states that require more money from the federal government. So maybe in that sense, yeah. But we get a lot of money back from the federal government, particularly for Medicaid, some of those programs, other programs. We're going to talk a little bit about that later, too.
I have a question as long as we're opening up. I'm interested, of course, in who it was that sold the Commonwealth on these reductions, what those forces are, because those are our enemy. And you're careful to present it as objective, and that's great, but you did slip in the heinous. There are people calling it heinous, and they were selling into these. Take away the heinous surplus, which could be providing us with wonderful services here, and instituted this tax cut. So I want your analysis of who those folks are.
So That's a great question. That was a little before my time. I'm not actually sure who the specific actors were.
They're still out there.
Yeah.
I mean, it's ratcheting. They built into the law so that it would ratchet it down.
Yep.
They get it passed once and they continue. I mean, that's really powerful.
I mean, there's, in general, it is my observation that, first of all, there are sort of specific organizations that are just anti-tax organizations, right, in Massachusetts that oppose, that are interested in reducing taxes.
Those membership organizations that corporations can be memberships of, members of?
I'm not sure if they're, I don't know the answer to that.
So Citizens for Limited Taxation was Barbara Anderson's group. They got a lot of corporate money to raise this campaign.
And my other question is, what is the top rate? Do we have a progressive income tax in Massachusetts?
So we're going to talk about that a little bit more.
Okay.
Hold that thought. That's a great question. So, you know, what has this done? So, you know, Massachusetts has lost a significant chunk of its revenue stream. Those of you folks here are probably active and pay attention to the budget process each year. You know, the last dozen years or more, far more often than not, we've been looking at, you know, finding ways to divert money that otherwise would have gone into the rainy day fund, even taking money out of the rainy day fund. What programs are we going to cut? You know, each year it's an exercise in belt tightening, you know, in no small measure because of some of the decisions that were made during the heydays of the dot-com bubble back in the late 90s. But just take a quick look at how that's affected a variety of areas of the state budget over that period. We'll run through a couple slides here. So Chapter 78, folks are probably familiar with this. One of the, I mean, is the principal mechanism by which money returns from the state back to municipalities throughout the Commonwealth to pay for K-12, pre-K-12 public education. Very important to local budgets and funding K-12 public education. This has seen a modest cut, inflation-adjusted cut over this period. So fallen by 3%. It's worth noting that cost structures within public education have changed a lot over the last 15, 20 years in terms of healthcare eating up a much larger chunk of the budget, a lot more money being dedicated to special education funding, which leaves, you know, what is...
Level funding of education is a monstrosity because nothing gets better.
It's not level funding. I mean, even though it appears to be level funding, in terms of the actual money available for, you know, regular programmatic educational sort of classroom education, you know, it's seen a significant cut. But overall, relatively flat funded during this period. General local aid is a different story. You know, again, this is the other major mechanism by which money flows back from the Commonwealth to 351 communities in Massachusetts. This pays for, you know, local towns, cities uses for supplement their fire departments, their police departments, help rebuild the roads, their libraries. Some of it actually goes to the schools as well. Very important source of funding historically for cities and towns in the Commonwealth. This has been, you know, cut very substantially. And again, this is inflation-adjusted dollars here, right? So this is real cuts over this time period. Communities have tried to make up some of the difference through increases in property taxes, but you know, they haven't been able to make up all that difference in many cases, and in any cases, we'll sort of review in a few minutes.
How did that happen? I mean, it seems to me that that's the place people want to spend money. They're all for those kinds of services.
I think it's just, I mean...
Nobody ever wants to spend money on education, so I don't know.
The politics, you know, are always complicated, but at the end of the day, there's... A big part of the answer to that question is simply a lack of revenue, and that cuts are going to happen somewhere.
But usually it would. That's just,
yeah.
Surprise.
Yep.
Surprise. I mean, organizing towns surprising to really skunk and shout about these cuts is part of what we're organizing to do.
Yep. So big cuts here. early education and care. So these are sort of, you know, state level programs, 24% cut over this time period. higher education, it's a big deal here in the Valley, of course. Dropped by 14%. Here's a slide that sort of I'm sure that Fern is well acquainted with these numbers, but you know, you see this slightly different time periods of different number, 11% instead of 14%, but you see what's happened at the same time, that state level funding for higher education has happened. Students and their families have been seeing very large increases in their tuition and fee costs. So it's not that the costs are changing or going down, right? It's that the costs are being shifted from the state, which doesn't have the resources, in some significant measure because of the tax cut that were implemented 15 years ago. And so other groups, whether it's cities and towns or individual students in this case, are bearing the cost of those shifts.
The whole theory behind this is that the people that use the services will end up paying more for it. How much of the rest of the budget could be constructed that way? In other words, I'm not sure I can come up with a clever example, but,
yeah.
You know, for example, sewer or water. I mean, we all pay according to how much we use.
Yep.
And, are there other things like that, you know, that could be a consumption tax that would be levied on the consumer of whatever it was?
I mean, theoretically, you could shift all kinds of different program costs to the people who are using them.
Look at the fees of state parks and things like that, and they have gone up, and they are instituting it, and you're right, they have a philosophy. We won't call them taxes, we'll call them user fees and screw the poor.
Healthcare is a great example. There's many different ways to pay for things. This is, in part, all of them, of course, are specific examples. Higher ed, as I'm sure Fern is aware, there's differences in how much control campuses retain over certain kinds of revenue streams. And so, when the state cuts something, the campuses have the ability to increase and retain certain other. I mean, so each one has its own story. But yeah, in principle, you could certainly have a pay-as-you-go government system. I don't think that would necessarily deliver great results in a lot of cases. It certainly wouldn't deliver fair results, what I would consider to be fair results, but.
And we should stop calling it a commonwealth.
That's right, it destroys the commons. It's not a commonwealth at that point.
So to sort of round out these last few things, public health, again, critically important. Government programs cut by 20%, 21%. Anything else in here? Environment and recreation you're talking about, cut by a third over this period. So that's sort of an overview of where Massachusetts stands relative to other states in terms of taxes, how that's changed over time, what some of the big packages were that played into the changes, and how it's affected the state budget.
If they didn't make those cuts, would have that covered those changes?
So that's a great question. It certainly would have gone a very long way. I mean, we're talking about $4 billion or more.
Well, some of those budgets were like 41%, that's a big percentage.
Right. So, I have not done the math on that. I don't have that figure at the top of my head. But yes, it would go a very long way towards restoring a lot of those cuts. Yep.
And $4 billion is about 10% of the budget.
Right. moving on to looking a little bit at just giving an idea of the revenue structure so people have a rough idea of the relative proportions here. The big three in terms of state and local taxes are property taxes, which are about a third, personal income taxes, which is state level tax, about a third, and the general sales tax. Together, those three represent 80% or something of total revenue stream for state and local taxes here in Massachusetts. It's got smaller shares, important shares, but coming from things like excise taxes, motor fuel taxes, cigarette taxes, alcohol taxes, corporate taxes, a variety of different things. And as Fern was saying, about $44 billion.
If you were to redraw that chart saying corporate versus personal, corporate pays property taxes. So I don't know what percentage that is. Personal is personal. General sales tax, some corporates. How would it look?
That is a good question. Corporations, I was just looking at this the other day. corporations in Massachusetts. So there's a good fact sheet on our website that you can go to. I think it's called Mass Business Taxes or something like that. The data is from 2014. I think the data are that businesses broadly defined pay about 40% of all these different taxes. So you're talking about property taxes, sales taxes, those kinds of things. Personal income tax, I mean, is through S corporations, as opposed to C corporations. That's sort of, so that's sort of the division there, about 40-60. But in terms of the direct and corporate income tax, right, this is a much smaller share. But you're absolutely right, businesses are paying, you know, some of these other taxes as well, absolutely. So looking now at sort of each of these individually and getting a sense of how they affect people in different income groups, it's called distributional analysis of the tax. So again, we're talking about the amount of household income instead of total household income, we're talking about, or you know, instead of total personal income for the entire state, we're talking about personal income for households in each of these different income categories. For example, and for a specific tax. So here we're looking at what share of total personal income is paid in sales taxes for people with income of less than $22,000 a year. It's about 2%. That's the lowest 20% of the income distribution. People in the middle, you know, earning between 44 and 70 are paying what, 1.5, 1.6, something like that. Of the top, people in the top 1%, the top 20% is sort of further divided into the top 1%, next 4%, next 15%. You can see the rough sort of income ranges of people in these different income groupings. Excuse me. And so, you know, what we see here is that it's, you know, this is just the technical term, it's regressive for this kind of tax, where people at the lower end of the distribution pay more than people at the upper end. It's a very clearly regressive structure to sales tax. I mean, a big part of the explanation for that is simply that when you're earning, you know, $22,000 a year, you are spending pretty much everything that you earn to purchase things that you need, and so much more of your income is subject to sales tax. By the time you get to some of the upper income levels, you're saving a lot of your money, you're investing it in different ways, it's not subject to the sales tax, so it's, you know, it's a much smaller share of your income is actually paid out, even if you're buying more expensive things.
Do we have a luxury tax?
We don't really have a luxury tax. No.
So the person that buys the $10,000 Honda pays exactly the same tax rate as the person that buys the $250,000 Rolls Royce?
So I think that's right in terms of the motor vehicle excise tax. In terms of like the local...
Local
excise tax? Yeah, I mean...
So...
houses, you know, stuff like that.
So the basic answer to that question is no, we do not have luxury taxes in Massachusetts. What else am I going to say about that? Yeah, the basic answer is no, we don't. The example I was going to give is there are certain things that, you know, clothing under a certain value is not subject to sales tax. If you buy a really expensive suit or coat or pair of shoes, then yes, it will be subject to the sales tax. It won't be subject to an additional tax, but you won't get the sort of, you know, total exemption from the tax, which you get for sort of modestly priced clothing.
I know it's off the topic, but what percentage of those different income ranges do you think go into the lottery?
I have no idea. I really don't. Yeah. But you know, the lottery collects...
And I know it pays it out through the charity sheets and all that other stuff, but I'm just curious about how much.
Yeah, no, I have no idea.
Go to your local corner store and find out.
I'm not going to ask them there.
No one's rolling. No one's driving up a Rolls Royce.
So property tax, again, regressive, not quite as sharply and clearly as sales tax, but again, a regressive tax. And last but not least, the income tax, which is quite a different pattern, as you can see here. It's the only major state or local tax that sort of bucks the trend of regressivity. This is a progressive tax. It's a little bit surprising in a way that it's progressive in Massachusetts because unlike most states, we actually have a flat rate structure. We have a single rate. Everybody pays the same rate on wage and salary income, now 5.1%. So you would certainly expect that everything would be largely uniform. That's not the case because there are a bunch of different elements of the state income tax that allow it to be progressive. We have the personal exemption is more beneficial to people at the lower end of the distribution. We have low and no tax status, so if you make very low income, you actually don't pay the income tax. We have the earned income tax credit, state earned income tax credit, available to people at the lower end, not at the higher end. So there's different elements which allow it to actually function in a progressive way. But
it caps out. If as you go along, could you also talk about the best of your knowledge, not just the top 1%, but the top 0.1%?
So yeah, when I can, I definitely will.
And thank you.
The story tends to be, I guess, what you're imagining, which is that the further up you go, the more benefits have been enjoyed in terms of income growth and so on, top 1%, top 1/10 of 1%, 100th of 1%, yes.
You went through the real estate tax really fast.
Yes, probably. Would you like to see that?
Yeah, so the real estate, that's a regressive tax, and that's what towns use to collect income, right?
Yep.
So a lot of our towns out here in Western Mass, the hill towns, we have people who are property rich and cash poor, like farmers.
Yep.
Is there a way for a town to address the way they collect? Can they collect taxes based on income instead of property?
So I think that would require some changes.
Legislation. Right?
Legislation.
Nice little platform. I like it.
There's also, there are mechanisms that towns can use to make a more progressive property tax. There's a circuit breaker program. It's called the circuit breaker program, which helps, which is only currently available to elderly people and I think a small set of people with certain specific disabilities. That through the income tax, if you have relatively low income and your property tax to total income ratio is relatively high, then you get up to maybe $1,800, maybe it's only $1,000, $900, $1,000 back from the state and your income taxes. There has been discussion. I believe I've written papers about the circuit breaker. You can call them on our website. I know that the Lincoln Land Institute, or I guess it's called the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy, has good papers about circuit breaker programs, and you can make them more generous. Instead of having $900,000 cap, you could have $2,000 or $3,000 coming back from the state. You can also open it up to people who are non-elders. You can open it up to people who have slightly lower ratios of...
Is this something that a town could do?
Yeah, with permission, yes.
Shouldn't do it with exemptions, because that's buying into their language. They would be better off to frankly say we're taxing the more expensive properties at a higher rate out front. Just do it progressively that way.
I mean, there are some towns I can't remember exactly how this is used, but in places where there are a lot of... people with second homes on the Cape, out in the Berkshires, where they have, you get a certain amount off your property tax for a first home, like your principal residence. So your first $50,000 or $100,000 is not taxed, and so the tax falls. It's a much higher tax on the value of your home above a certain level. But that falls much more so than, of course, on people who have higher. Now, that may not be so great for farmers. If there are a lot of vacation homes, it could be, right?
Well, the farmers have, their income is awful these days.
Right, no, but I guess what I'm saying is if you don't tax them the first $100,000, but they have $1 million of property value, then they're paying a higher tax on the remaining $900,000.
Yeah.
So,
there's a program where they can get bought, they sell their development rights, and it stays open land, and they continue to farm at a lower tax rate.
So there are things that can be done. There are different mechanisms, short of trying to base local revenue streams on a local income tax. Although, it's complicated for a variety of reasons, but it's not unheard of or a terrible idea. It's just complicated.
Why is this called progressive? It's not proportional. So it doesn't look very progressive to me.
So proportional is a term that's typically used to describe a flat. In sort of parlance of tax discussions, proportional is sort of like flat effect. It's considered flat proportional.
I'm looking at income. I'm looking at percent. If I go from 118,000 to 860,000, that's a eight times increase without a corresponding increase in the percentage.
You know why? Because the top 0.1% are hidden in that. There are tax policies that favor them, and it's not an accident that it caps out where it does, because the rest of it is hidden.
Yeah, if you divide it up,
that's the billionaires.
Much higher. The rest of it caps out quite a bit. I'm not quite sure.
But the value of that bar is higher than all the other bars combined.
Exactly. So,
I mean, there is money coming
yeah,
in.
So this maybe it's a presentation bar.
Maybe, yeah.
It should be dollars instead of percentage.
Yeah, so the thing that the value of doing it as a share of household incomes, it sort of allows you to, it allows you to make an apples-to-apples comparison in the sense of, like, ability to pay. Right? So a household has a certain amount of a certain pie to work with. Some of those pies are small, some of those pies are big. How much of the pie that you have available to you is being collected in taxes? For these folks, in this case, a much larger slice of their actual pie, which is huge relative to some of these other folks, right? But I guess it's viewed as a way of being able to make a reasonable apples-to-apples comparison of amount collected as a share of resources available. That's the intention. So this is sort of everything put together in one big pile. This includes some of the things we're talking about: corporate taxes, the excise taxes. Corporate taxes are sort of, there's a formula or a methodology for assigning those amongst the various households in these different income brackets. What you wind up seeing is that Massachusetts, like most other states, overall has a regressive structure.
Do you have the 0.1% approximation here that's missing at the
rest? I don't. You're absolutely right. It is inside of that top 1% there. I don't have it. But one would have to think that it was still lower still.
Right. So
that's sort of an overview of various taxes and relative regressivity or progressivity of each of the individual ones and the system as a whole. Gentleman over here had asked about ways to change the tax structure in Massachusetts. We've written, our organization, I've written a lot about many, many different ways to look at that, to do that. There have been different campaigns, and we've analyzed those proposals over the last dozen years. So there's a lot of ways of going about this. There is currently under discussion, actually, for moving politically, as many of you are aware, a millionaire's tax proposal, the Fair Share Amendment. And I'm just going to sort of describe that, give some people some information about that. The broad outline of the proposal, many of you are probably aware already, Massachusetts is constitutional. In Massachusetts, we're constitutionally currently prohibited from taxing different income levels at different rates. It's just part of our constitution. Any specific category of income, wage and salary income, for example, all has to be taxed at a uniform rate. So right now it's 5.1%. To allow us to tax higher incomes at a different rate, or to create income brackets and income rates in the same way that the federal government had, the federal income tax structure does that, we need to change our state constitution in order to be able to do that. So there's an amendment, moving through the ballot initiative process for a constitutional amendment that would create a millionaire's tax. It would create a two bracket system: one, taxable income below $1 million. The second bracket would be taxable income above $1 million.
Annual income. $1 million. The reason that's so taxable is that we were told to call it the $20,000 a week tax rather than the millionaire tax, because some of the opposition is going to come from folks that worked hard for a long time and they built up an equity of a million or a million and a half or something. They're not millionaires. The millionaires people get $1 million in income every year. So if you call it the tax on $20,000 a week, it works better for people.
It's not a wealth tax.
It's on annual taxable income. So you would pay an additional 4 percentage points on your second million of income and above, which by the time that if it were approved, that would go into effect in 2019 under the current schedule. And it's very likely that the base rate that people will be paying at that point will be 5%. So it would be 5% tax on the first $1 million of taxable income, and then an additional 4% or 9% top marginal rate on income above $1 million.
One income above, you don't pay the 9% for the first million. You only pay it on what's on the marginal rate above that.
And that $1 million threshold is indexed to inflation, so that would grow over time. Additionally, the amendment is written such that the income generated, the revenue generated from this proposal, would be earmarked for education and transportation. So we talked a lot about different cuts in the budget over the last bunch of years. Those are important impacts on important programs, and this proposal would not be generating money to backfill those kinds of cuts. This money would be earmarked, some of them, higher education, some of the transportation stuff, but not broadly speaking. The money in this proposal would be earmarked specifically for education and transportation. The Department of Revenue has estimated that it would generate about $1.9 billion in 2019. So the better part of $2 billion in additional revenue. It would impact about half of 1% of filers in Massachusetts, about 20,000 households, a little less than 20,000 households. Yeah?
Would there be any guarantee that money would go to education and transportation perhaps equally? Because it seems to me, and my memory may be wrong, but it seems to me that when we started doing selling lottery tickets, that money was supposed to go to education.
So was the cigarette money.
So,
to health, and it didn't.
So right, the lottery money generally comes back to general local aid, to communities, and they, right, often spend it on other things than education. I think it would be up to the legislature. It is, in fact, up to the legislature to determine how that money would be spent. Given the, both in terms of the way the statute is written and in terms of the political sort of calculus of what had been approved, I think the strong belief and consensus, people that I talked to about it, is that money would, in fact, go to education and transportation. How that's allocated between education and transportation, I don't know. I mean,
can you give us Mass Budget's choice of transportation? Because that's interesting, because it could have been education and healthcare, it could have been education and housing, or education. So why transportation?
So I think the underlying rationale for that, it's we didn't write this bill. There's a Raise Up Massachusetts coalition that's working on this. That's not a bill, but this amendment, this constitutional amendment, this proposal. I think the underlying rationale is that these are two areas which have been significantly underfunded, that have a lot of need, and which are sort of fundamental to the economic well-being of the state. That these are core sort of building block elements to a prosperous economy, and one that can share that prosperity broadly.
And we should get some support even from business, because transportation assists, lowers their costs. So.
And absolutely, that they enjoy broad support.
And they did a bunch of polling as far as what areas are kind of the most popular, and these came out.
That's what I was asking, yeah.
Yes, I think that's absolutely correct.
Will they change their minds because of the recent concern over health care?
So this bill, this proposal is as it is. It's a ballot initiative. It's been approved. Been approved by the Attorney General as it stands, et cetera, et cetera. It's not changing.
Was there 20,000 households that would be in Massachusetts that would be impacted by the progressive top tip income tax, right? Is that what you said?
Like that, exactly.
So we're asking those 20,000 people to chip in more of their fair share.
Right, exactly. So looking very quickly at some of the stuff about transportation and education, to your point, businesses very much in favor of increased investments in transportation, particularly on some of the debacles we saw over the last couple of winters.
You're standing in front of the slide.
Here, they all crouch down here. So I keep clicking on this. You know, just a couple of things. The T, maybe not the principal concern of most people in Western Mass. I grew up out here. I live out here. I understand that, you know, the T isn't necessarily something that most of us think about every day. Boston is a huge economic driver for Massachusetts and the region generally. Investments in a well-functioning T, I think, are important for the state as a whole. You know, this is
but investments in mass transportation out here would go so far for the climate crisis.
So, absolutely, and you know, part of the I don't think that the RTAs will be ignored. If there is additional funding for transportation as a result of approval of the fair share amendment, I don't think the RTAs will be ignored. The regional transit authorities. Yes. So you know, this is just an example of the underfunding that we have in the T system. You know, there's repairs to roads and general maintenance. I think there's a federal study showing that every dollar invested in basic maintenance saves $6 or something like that in car repairs and other kinds of problems for drivers. So you know, a good investment for people. Here's another example of investment that has worked well. We had an accelerated bridge repair program. When it started back in 08, there were some 540 structurally deficient bridges. Absent the bridge repair program, we would have seen close to 700 structurally deficient bridges. But we had we invested $3 billion through this program. And lo and behold, we brought the number of structurally deficient bridges down to 410. There are still a lot of structurally deficient bridges. This program phased out. This is the kind of program that could be brought back with additional funding and repair our bridges and also creating good jobs.
That last part, and creating good jobs to do it.
Yeah. Huh. And access to commerce.
Right, exactly. You know, one of the things that, in terms of education, another really important area that drives the economy, there's often a suggestion that these kinds of investments, which require tax increases, are actually going to be a drag on the economy. And you know, that's something we can sort of run a good test on. We have 50 states in the U.S. with 50 different state tax structures. Attacks residents at different levels in terms of how much of the household income they collect, and we can see how their state economies perform. So this graph is, we're going to see the 50 states up here, and you're going to see states sort of on the horizontal axis laid out based on how much of total household, total annual state, you know, personal income is collected through state and local taxes versus the hourly wage. Median hourly wage in the state, which seems like a good measure of how well the economy in that state is performing for people, the general workers in that state. And so what you see here is not a lot of pattern. There are states that have collected relatively low taxes, that have poor wages, that have high wages. We have taxes states that collect relatively larger share of income, that have low wages, that have high wages. Taxes do not appear to be closely linked to how well a state economy performs for the workers in that economy. By contrast, let's look at how educational levels of the workforce relate to worker wages. So again, same idea here, except the bottom horizontal axis is going to show you the percentage of the state's workforce that has a bachelor's degree or higher. And then we're still going to see hourly median wages by state. And what you see here, instead of just a mess of dots all over, as we did the last time largely, you see a very tight correlation. There are very, very few outliers. Every state is, clustered closely around this trend line. The better educated the workforce, the higher the median wages in the state, the better for the workers. Massachusetts clearly is, up here, is the best educated workforce in the country. And it's worth doubling down on that investment. That's sort of our national calling card. That's our comparative advantage. We have a highly educated workforce. We don't have lots of gas or oil or timber or these other things like Alaska and Wyoming.
Cranberries.
We have cranberries. That's a good point. This is an investment, an area that we can invest in and help the state in many ways and the workers in the state. It's interesting to note, just looking, 40 years ago now, the same slide here. First of all, you can see that by and large, states have much lower levels of education and workforce, and the slope of that trend line is very different. I mean, as you saw in the last one, we're talking about $5 to $7 an hour spread between states that have less educated workforces and more educated workforces. In the last slide we were looking at here, it's a couple of dollars. It's also the case that here you can see that, this was an economy where you had coal, where you had major manufacturing, Michigan, Ohio, Indiana. We had state workforces that had unions with jobs for people with high school or lower educational levels that still delivered good wages relative to others. That's not the economy we live in.
West Virginia.
Wage rates inflation adjusted, so we're looking at the same vertical scale?
Yeah.
Could you go back to the last slide for a second?
Yes.
Whoops.
So yeah, steep slope. So that's just to show that education is important. It has real impacts on people's day-to-day lives, and this is an area that we've underinvested in over the last 15 years, particularly higher education, and can reinvest it with additional revenue. So turning to some of the questions that down over the corner here is raised about relative benefits to different income groups in Massachusetts and the country as a whole. Looking again, this is sort of all the context of folks who proposed a millionaire's tax, and sort of showing here that that tax would fall on those folks who have actually benefited to a very significant degree from a lot of income inequality over the last 30 years in Massachusetts. What you see here is folks in the bottom 90% on average, bottom 90% of the income distribution in Massachusetts during this period saw pretty weak annual average growth in their income, less than 0.5%. Meanwhile, on average, folks in the top 1% were seeing gangbusters annual average income growth. So, very significant disparity. The argument is often made that that's the way the system works, that's why it works, that we have people working very hard to see those kind of benefits. If you don't have winners and losers, you're not going to get sort of overall growth in the economy, that this is the driving force of capitalism and the only way the economy as a whole will grow. Well,
it's just kind of only 1% of the people work.
This is the beginning of the regulation.
It's a very big difference. We can test that hypothesis because we ran that experiment in the United States for 30 years in the post-World War II era, and whoops, wrong direction. So this is what it looked like during a period of very significant growth and sort of compression of income disparities in this period, post-war period, when the middle class grew very significantly, people's quality of life. Not everyone, there are large communities that were left out of this, but importantly, as a whole, this is a very different picture. We had strong growth and a very different picture in terms of how that growth was shared.
Taxes were a lot higher. Right?
Yeah, taxes were much higher for upper income groups.
A detail in that I've heard that during the Reagan administration, they changed the tax structure so that earlier than that, it was beneficial for the super rich to leave their money in the corporation where it would often get invested for jobs, and they made a change so that they gave an incentive for the wealthy to take their money out in capital gains and more speculative income, and that change alone is responsible for a lot of this.
I don't know the details on that, but that actually that sounds very familiar to me as well. But yeah, you'd have to do some sort of looking at other resources than the ones I know we'll give you tonight to confirm that. This is just sort of the point being that you know, the FSA has one proposal. There's been many different proposals for collecting additional revenue primarily or exclusively from folks at the very top of the income distribution. And, you know, this is an argument saying these are the people that have benefited to a very significant extent over the last 30 years. It's not, and at the same time, enjoyed significant tax cuts. That is a significant tax cut for the same period. It's not entirely unreasonable to suggest that this same group of people contribute a little bit more for the sort of basic bedrock investments that we make as a state and our economy and our people.
Does that, those people, are they roughly the same 22,000 households that
we I mean, roughly, we're talking about the top 1%,
yeah.
So yeah. You know, I mean, people, different households pop in and out of the 1%, some are only 1 year there, some are there, you know,
yeah,
year after year, but yes,
but
I am talking about the top 1%.
What they can harness in public opinion against progressive taxation by a lot of folks at the middle and upper strata who get frightened with tax increases, but they're really just protecting, you know, this tiny group, 22,000 people.
So, you know, we sort of went through this with the, but this is a coarser grained look, a less refined look at the tax shares paid by different income groups. We're looking at about 99%, you know, on average, state and local taxes take up about 9.4% of household income, about 99%. For the top 1%, that figure is about 6.5%. So there's a substantial disparity there. The if you know the folks in the top 1% were taxed at roughly you know, the same average rate, if they're taking the same average rate, we'd be getting over $1 billion additional revenue each year in state and local taxes. looking specifically at the fair share amendment. Yes, we are. So this we just looked at, see this, you know, before fair share amendment, this is what it would look like after the fair share amendment. It would not be, you know, perfectly equal, but it would be less regressive, excuse me, than it currently is. You know, it's worth noting that despite the fact that people in the top 1% would be paying more under the fair share amendment were approved, they still would not be paying as much as the other 99% of people in terms of share of household income. You know, we talked a little bit about this top marginal rate, 9%. There are, you know, 8 to 12 other states that have similar top rates, somewhere between 8 and I think the very top rate in California is 13.3%.
California's doing quite well.
But you know, just to point out that the fact that there's a top marginal rate of 9% is not the same thing as people paying 9% of their income in taxes. It's only that rate only applies to a portion of their income above $1 million. You know, looking at what's called the effective tax rate, how much, what the real world impacts are, you know, how much of their household income is actually being collected in state and local taxes. With the fair share amendment, you'd be looking at this kind of a collection, right, an effective tax rate. So not the 9% that people are talking about, you know, up in the top, whatever, tier of rates in the country, but a significantly lower rate. As people also may be aware, on your federal taxes, you are allowed to deduct your state and local taxes for people who are itemizing. So the overwhelming majority of high-income households are itemizing. When they go to file their federal taxes, they get to say, hey, I paid all of this money to Massachusetts. Please take that off the income that you're going to tax at the federal level. So you actually get a significant tax break at the federal level based on how much state and local taxes you pay. What does it amount to? Given the tax rates that people in these income groups are paying, it's about a third of the value. So if they're paying, if someone's paying, you know, whatever, $60,000 in state and local taxes, they're getting about a $20,000 break on their federal taxes. So it's really, depends on where you want to say that, you know, that benefit is coming from, but really the state tax is actually only costing them $40,000, even though the state is getting $60,000 for it. So when you take that into consideration, the, you know, the top effective rates are significantly lower. So we're not talking about people paying 9% of their income in state and local taxes under the FSA. We're talking about, you know, less than 5% for, you know, some folks, and right, or a little above 5% for others. How much time do we have, and how quickly should we be moving on
so
here?
We need to close out at 7:45 because the library closes at 8:00. We have to move furniture around.
Okay. So a couple more.
Maybe a little bit more, and then a little time for a question.
Great. Also, you know, very quickly, this is not something I'm an expert in, but I'll try and talk people through a little bit of it here. So there have been some federal budget proposals recently that have excited some interest. Let's just to give people a little bit of information about federal revenues in Massachusetts and how that affects Massachusetts. So we're sort of turning here from state-specific taxes to looking at the state budget and how it the federal monies affect the state budget. So federal revenue accounts for about a quarter of all the revenue that we use on an annual basis here in Massachusetts in the budget process, like within the budget, within the actual state budget. Much of that comes from comes through the Medicaid program. It's about $11 billion from the federal government. About $9 billion is flowing through the Medicaid program. Another $2 billion through a variety of other programs. There's been discussion about ACA repeal, the Obamacare, American...
discussion?
Yes, well, there's a proposal of that, yes. It's been in the papers, you may have heard. Affordable Care Act. One of the elements of the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, was to make it more enticing for states to expand their Medicaid programs to more people. Massachusetts took the federal government up on that and increased, brought in another, so about 1.9 million people in Massachusetts are insured under the Medicaid program. I think something like, there was an additional 210,000 people or something like that that came in under the expansion program. That brings in another $2 billion a year from the federal government. The federal government reimburses the way the Medicaid program works is we basically pay for a bunch of services for the people who need them, and in a very simplified version, send that bill to send that accounting to the federal government, and they reimburse us for 50% of that. Some states get as much as 70% reimbursement rate. Massachusetts is relatively well off. We get a 50% reimbursement for that. Massachusetts is getting an additional $2 billion through ACA expansion. We're spending an additional $2 billion. We're getting this additional federal reimbursement. With the expansion program, rather than getting a 50% reimbursement as an enticement, states got much higher reimbursement rates. Massachusetts is getting an 86% reimbursement rate. So basically, the feds are paying for almost all of the additional spending under the federal, expansion. The expansion, the sort of enhanced portion of the expansion, that going from 50% to 86% means that we're getting an additional $776 million. One of the things each year from the federal government to help us cover those folks, one of the things that's been under discussion is whether they might eliminate the enhanced reimbursement rate. If that happened, we would then be looking at a $776 million hole in the state budget. That's a big hole. There's also discussion about turning it into a block grant program, meaning that rather than sending the bill to the feds at the end of the year and having them reimburse us for 50% of whatever we spent, the federal government would instead say, look, this is how much you're going to get. You figure out how to spend it. We're going to increase that by some, adjust that for inflation a little bit each year, but that doesn't account for, much higher levels, rates of health care cost growth than sort of standard inflation. It doesn't account for changes in number of people enrolled in the program, all those additional costs.
The baby boomers aging.
So all of those additional kinds of costs would, under that kind of a structure, would fall to Massachusetts to bear. There's also discussion about sort of this cap per capita cap program. So they were this under that structure, the federal government would assign a specific amount that would flow from the federal government to the states for each person in the program based on sort of you being categorized, like are you very sick, are you not so sick, do you have these, so I don't know how many categories, there would be half dozen different categories, there would be a certain dollar amount associated with each person in each of those categories, and that amount would be sent to the states, and then you would have to figure out, the state would have to figure out how to pay for it. If cost structures change, if cost increase, all those changes would be borne by the state under either of those plans. So there are, you know, and what we're looking at here is for the U.S. as a whole, projections that federal government would, eliminate up to 370 billion dollars of costs back to the states over that time. That's a big bill out of the states. I think almost finally here, just these.
Can we go back to that? Yeah. Where did you?
There's another $2 billion or so in. So this is the. This is the. I'm not quite sure. So these, I think, some of this is Medicare mixed in stuff, but basically the point here is that there are a lot of other services besides just Medicaid that are getting funding, federal dollars, to help support state funding as well.
Just look at that bottom line, the Department of Mental Health, 15% federal cut, and with our opioid epidemic, that goes away and people are going to die.
The opioid crisis has been a big deal. These are other areas that receive federal funding outside of the budget process. LIHEAP has been talked about. That's one of the programs that was suggested being eliminated, essentially, funding, which is the fuel assistance program for low-income folks during the winter. I think the administration's budget eliminates funding for that, as an example. These are other areas that receive significant dollars from the state, from the federal government outside of the standard budget process. Anyhow, I'm going to end there.
Are these slides available on your website?
They aren't. We can make some of them available through a PDF. I'd ask for David not to to wait until I share the PDF version of it, rather than share the sort of PowerPoint version of it. I can make those. I can get that to these guys.
It seems to me, I remember back in the late 70s and 80s, the corporate tax contribution to the state budget was higher than 5%. I remember it being like 15%.
Okay.
And it's slowly gone down. But yep. How would we find?
I got that question. I did have a few tax, corporate tax things. I think part of that shift is, that's a nationwide shift. There's been a steady decline in the total amount of taxes collected, that comes from corporations, the share of the total that comes from corporations. And that, has a whole host of reasons, not least of which is that a lot of corporations have smaller corporations sort of move towards filing taxes through the personal income tax, which is something that some corporations, depending on their size and other factors, can do. So some of that has been shifted over to personal income tax rather than the corporate tax. But just as some of the questions I think that Ferd had forwarded to me prior to the talk, they're just looking at Massachusetts business taxes. There's a report that I mentioned earlier that people can find on the website, but Massachusetts actually is relatively low in terms of business taxes as a share of gross state product. Here's another measure. This is sort of pre-tax profits. Again, Massachusetts is pretty middle of the road in that regard. So Massachusetts has elements that are more expensive for businesses. Businesses often talk specifically about, particularly manufacturing for electrical costs, various power costs. So they argue that they need low taxes because there are these other costs that they're bearing by remaining in this region. But yeah, overall that trend, I mean, I think there's all kinds of factors going on there. I think there's increased tax avoidance, efforts in tax avoidance. There's less of a sense of responsibility. So there's, you know, been a real push over the last 30 or 40 years in this sort of anti-tax, anti-government climate to just not pay those taxes, to not bear that burden, rather than seeing the businesses understanding themselves to be sort of woven into the fabric of our society and needing to support it, you know, as well. There are, you know, there's also corporations that move overseas, and there's the whole multinational aspect of it, and this sort of shift to the private S-corp structure rather than the C-corp structure. You know, if you go, if you're interested in that question, a couple of places you could do some research on the Center on Budget Policy Priorities that's written about that. There's another organization called Center on Economic Policy Research, CPR, writes about some of those things. So those are great questions and things that people are talking about. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Are other people you prefer?
Well, I was going to make two comments. One, I've done a lot of work in higher ed, and the work of Mass Budget has been just incredible. There's a great report that they have that shows what would it actually cost to have free higher ed in Massachusetts. And it pegs it at several different levels. So if people are interested, I'd recommend that. And the other thing I was going to say about the Fair Share Amendment. So the big hurdle was getting how many signatures? 150,000? I don't know.
Yeah, something like that.
I think we collected more signatures than that than any ballot initiative or has ever collected in Massachusetts. So then the next step was that a quarter of the legislature had to vote in favor of it. More than half of the legislature, in fact, voted in favor. That same process has to happen again. Again, this calendar year, a quarter of the legislature has to vote for it. That'll happen. And then it goes on the ballot. And I assume we're going to all be involved in that campaign.
Is that 2018?
2018 election. The Fair Share will be on the ballot.
It's a constitutional amendment.
It's a constitutional amendment, yeah.
I wonder, there's another source of money, which is, so I wonder what you think about green bank ideas, where the pension funds of Massachusetts and state employees and all the funds that come as state government go into a locally chartered Massachusetts bank, the way they have it in North Dakota.
Right, so probably 8 years ago, I did some research about that. Right, I remember there's this one example in North Dakota. It's worked very well in North Dakota. I don't really remember many of the details about it, but I think it's certainly something worth exploring based on my recollection of, you know, my reading at the time. It seems like a very worthwhile thing to explore.
This is terrific.
Well, thank you. Thank you for your questions. You put your name on the email list and you'll be sure to get
everybody signed in who didn't sign in or wants to be on Kurt's email list.